Hi, welcome to another edition of Real Soul. I'm Lee Bay.
And I'm Vaughn Monroe.
And today we're going to talk about foreign films, black foreign films, a sort of underseen genre of movies.
Yeah, you know, a lot of times you hear people say, when it comes, you know, look, foreign films are foreign.
Right.
Which means they're probably going to be speaking a language that we don't necessarily speak, and then you got subtitles. And I've heard people say a lot of times, if I have to read it, then it's not really a movie, which is unfortunate because there's some fantastic foreign films that are worthy of our attention for their skill and the way that they sort of talk about the universalness of our humanity.
Indeed, indeed. My choice for a great foreign film is a 2010 movie that was made, of all places, in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, in Africa. And it's the Congo's first major film in 20 years, and it's called Viva Riva. And it's kind of a film noir, but not in style, in terms of like black and whites and shadows, but really in substance, where you know there are people who are pursuing a thing. In this case, it's petroleum, it's gas, which is a good thing. Drugs, not diamond heist, but gasoline. And it pits essentially two bad guys against each other, and both against the central character Riva, this kind of character and man about town and sort of operator who sort of operates in an interesting way. So the clip we're going to see now involves one of the bad guys, who is played by the great Hoji Fortuna, who's a fantastic actor that hopefully we'll be hearing more from. And he's approaching a military police officer there to try to get her on his side, and he uses an interesting way to do it.
Yeah.
So let's take a look at the clip.
Madame la commandante, ça fait ton bail.
Il ferait mieux d'aller discuter dans mon bureau.
Je cherche un mec qui vient d'arriver, Riva.
Et alors?
Il a débarqué à Mariano. Je vais te user de le retrouver.
Je peux te dire que Mariano est une station des camions. Et même te donner l'adresse. Mais j'ai déjà un travail.
Gare est facile. Il aime sortir, la grande vie. On a un business avec lui. Et il y a un business pour toi.
Peut-être me suis-je mal exprimé.
Dekonanga, salisanga. Salanyoso César aza kusenga yo. Na ko expliquer yo sima. Naza malamu. Mais sala o nyoso basengi yo. Ndekonayo o alinga ka o mingi, Rosie.
You know, okay, you talked about this as a film noir, neo-noir, because the new ones have color.
Exactly.
But the noir always has some element of sexuality in there, and it has some element of danger as well. And a lot of times in American noirs, it seems like, because we cast actors, and it seems like in black noirs, we cast actors. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You don't believe that they can really get down and do anything. They don't have any sense of danger. They have nothing.
Mm-hmm.
That brother was dangerous.
Oh,
you know
indeed,
what I'm saying?
Indeed.
It's like if you saw him, if you saw him on the other side of it, he's the type of cat that if he steps in the room, it's like, and he steps on the periphery, I need to know where he's at, because if some jumps off, I'm getting him first.
Right. And that is an interesting observation because, without giving away too much of the plot, it pits his bad guy coolness against another bad guy who's more of and both of them are after Riva for different reasons, who's more of the stereotypical movie bad guy, and how they contrast and who wins is actually pretty interesting and goes nicely to what you just said.
Yeah.
But great performances here. Again, Hoji Fortuna was the bad guy there. I like how He slides the hat across the thing, and she expects a bribe because that's the way things are done. And it turns out that it isn't. It's a threat. That, you know, his sister saying, "Help me do what he says, otherwise he's gonna get at me."
And that's also sophisticated filmmaking because we have that conversation often where what you're supposed to do is you have to give the audience some of what it is that they expect, but you can't give them all of what they expect. You have to keep them guessing. You have to keep them moving a little bit off balance. So this is one way where something that could be cliche is played differently, and it actually, you know, the fact that there's this frilly pink envelope with the picture in there, and then it's like the coolness of, you know, he looks at her balefully while she reads, she reads that sort of plea for help from sister, like, look, I'm okay, but do what this man is saying, because, you know, and just the whole sense of threat and menace to it, that's not about like, it's the usual overacting stuff from cats who don't really, who don't have the gravitas to play that type of danger.
Indeed. I mean, what's truly scary is what you can't quite see and what isn't quite revealed to you. And I think that his character kind of puts on great performances here. There's one young actress in here who plays the love interest of at least two of the characters. Mamie Malone, who's a French actress, who's quite beautiful. I'm sure someone you're going to be seeing more of.
Hopefully,
in one way or another. And a brother, Pashta Bey, plays, who, no relation to me, spells it differently, his last name, plays Reva, the central character.
Okay, so, you know, my choice is a French film called 35 Shots of Rum.
Ah.
It's done by Claire Denis, and it's very different in tone and feel. Basically, it's a story of a father and his daughter. It's made clear that they're still together because of in the aftermath of some tragedy. But you know, she's a grown woman, and you know, is ready to move on, get her own space, and she's worried about her father. But you know, let's let the clip do the talking.
Indeed. A great scene, and you almost forget that it's wordless. I mean, it's a French movie. Mm-hmm. We don't hear any French, but everything is communicated in subtlety and in eyes and the emotion and feeling and music in some respects.
You know, that's one thing that I actually, you know, I think is really interesting about black people, particularly with cinema, because there's that essay that James Baldwin wrote where he talked about how black people learn to communicate with each other wordlessly, but we learned that, and he was talking about us during the civil rights era, because when we were around power structures, we had to learn to communicate very effectively with each other with glances and body language and proximity and understanding, because we couldn't always speak out loud at risk of death. I do remember that being in the essay. And this scene shows you what, and there's a way sometimes where foreign cinema is not always as reliant on dialogue to communicate what's happening, but it takes a more sophisticated, skilled director to be able to find like this where the glance is at, where the body proximity is at, where the movement is at, how the actor is positioning themselves to show that I'm inviting you in, or I'm embarrassed, or don't do that, but come, or you know, the various things that play themselves out, the various emotions, the obstacles that play themselves out in this scene.
So true. I mean, very brave choice for the director and for the actors too, to sort of use the lack of words and just nuance to kind of get across. I agree, an American film, if you're talking about the difference between American and foreign films, an American film might have been tempted to sort of chat that scene up.
Yeah.
People explain, and when the guy sits down, when the girl sits down to sort of tell him what's happening, but they leave it to us to figure out. And it's a movie of great subtlety, which I think is the power. You know, you turned me onto this movie, and I didn't know the plot, and I watched it, just sort of discovering it as I went along, and I found myself, and this is the beauty of seeing films that are outside of your normal sphere of films, is that I found myself matching the scenes with my expectations, thinking, okay, well, here's where it's going to be found out that the guy deals drugs. Nope. You know, here's going to be when the guy falls off the building and dies. Nope. You know, here's going to be when she tells him off about, or this character tells, and it doesn't happen. And when it does happen, it doesn't happen in the way that we like it. So do we see it? So it's a beautiful, beautiful, subtle film, and certainly one worth checking out.
I agree. Well, that wraps up this installment of Real Soul with respect to foreign films. Next installment, we're going to be talking about the one-hour drama. And, you know, what's really interesting about the one-hour drama is typically it's said that the 50s was the golden age of television. And that's because they had live theater on television. But I feel that the golden age of television is actually right now with respect to the one-hour drama.
Indeed. So, indeed.
Narrowing that down to just one was hard, but, you know. All right, I'm Von Monroe.
And I'm Lee Bay.
And it's another installment of Real Soul. Keep it real.